Hello everyone. Thank you for joining us for the Imaginal Talk series on learning and skill development this evening. There are some more participants still joining in, hence we will wait for 5 more minutes and we will start the session by 6:05, please. Thank you. Welcome to Vayati Systems and Research. I'm Nidhi, Senior Associate and your host for the talk. After a successful 6 months of running Imaginal Talk series on learning and skills development, we are back with the seventh episode. This is a discourse that requires all of us to be involved and engaged in. It has the power to shape ourselves and those around us and our collective future. Before we begin today's session, I would like to inform that we have posted a link in the chat box and we would like to hear your feedback at the end of the session. To initiate the conversation, we have three distinguished personalities: Dr. Mona N. Shah, founder and director, Vayati Systems and Research, and author of Millennials Poised to Lead, a bestseller book on Amazon. In conversation with Mr. Mayank Singh Thakur, partner, Masson Projects, and Mr. Abhijatya Kumar, director at Deloitte India. I'm sure this evening will not only be an interesting one, but also packed with many takeaways. Without further delay, let's proceed to hear today's guest on Imaginal Talk. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Nidhi. A hearty welcome to all those who have joined our seventh live episode of the Imaginal series this year. Let me introduce you first to the idea behind the series. It is conceived to offer very personal perspectives about the role learning has played in the lives of our guests. As an academic, I see firsthand the whole idea of learning is undergoing a radical change. There is so much that is thought, spoken, written, experienced, questioned, and planned in policies that it has left the whole world in a conundrum about its relevance or its utility. This talk series is dedicated to deconstructing and understanding this very change. Many asked me actually about why we've named the talk Imaginal. What is Imaginal? Actually, Imaginal is the last stage after which the caterpillar transforms into a butterfly. We also know it as the pupa stage. The entire metamorphosis of the butterfly is an almost magical process rarely found elsewhere in the world of living species. For one, the different forms in the metamorphosis are distinct from one another, so distinct that while in a particular stage, it would be difficult to imagine how the next form would appear for those who see it from the outside. And do you know, this stage-wise development is also completely lost on the butterfly. It does not remember how it looked when it was a caterpillar, and neither does the caterpillar know how it would look in future when it becomes a butterfly. Miraculous, isn't it? In all my 3 decades and more as a professor and a strong proponent of all things educational, I frequently came across the lines being repeated from learners. We never really learn anything while in school. It's only when we experience the hard knock of reality that we really learn. Much like the caterpillar, which has no clue what it will become in the future, most of us go through learning not knowing exactly how it had been designed to help us to grow into useful and beautiful individuals in society. Interestingly, though, this view on learning held by multitudes has always been in contradiction to another reality. The reality being that the desire to enroll in good colleges and acquire degrees is equally appealing. In some cultures, the parents are ready to sacrifice their present for the future of their wards. There are countless cases of leaders who have been supported to invest in their ambitions. On the other hand, there are made it big billionaires like Howard Schultz, the CEO of Starbucks, and Oprah Winfrey, who had disadvantaged childhood, or a Mark Zuckerberg, who dropped out of Harvard to launch Facebook. At another level, we all are aware that there is no better comparative advantage than that of a highly skilled human resource for any country to do well at the global scale. So then why educate oneself if it lacks clarity or is either forgotten or is seen as irrelevant at a later date? Why does formal education continue to command more premium instead of only relying on academic degrees? Can continuous competency and skilling be the way forward? So, Today, I shall ask my guests and viewers, why these contradictions? We present to you a number of guests from diverse backgrounds who will express their ideas on learning with anecdotes from their own personal journeys. They will share how learning helped, or for that matter, did not help, in their own growth and development. We also urge you to post your reactions and comments and engage with our guests for this evening, Mayank Singh Thakur, partner at Masson Projects India, and Abhijatya Kumar, director, Deloitte India. Thank you, Mayank and Abhijatya, for joining us today and agreeing to share your own experiences on this show.
Thank you, ma'am.
Let me begin with Mayank. Let me give you a brief of Mayank's professional career and his achievements. So Mayank Singh Thakur is a mechanical engineer with a master's in construction management with 17 and more years of experience in claims and disputes, contracts management, and project controls. He is a specialized delay and quantum expert for engineering and construction disputes and claims. He has served as claims analyst on numerous projects and has testified as expert in arbitration. His project experience includes oil and energy, infrastructure development, real estate, and power projects. His earlier stints have been in companies like Kalpataru, SR, and Punj Lloyd, before moving into consultancy roles with Chambers and now Masson Projects. Mayank is known to all as a strong organizer, taking along people of various skills and temperaments. In the capacity of partner, needless to say, he works with a cross-section of highly motivated and evolved individuals and a large range of stakeholders. In his spare time, he plays the bongo. It is perhaps this superior sense of rhythm that enables him to perform consistently in all roles that he plays professionally and personally. Coming to Abhijatya. Abhijatya is a director with Deloitte in India. He is an architect and has a master's in advanced construction management with over 12 years of strong professional experience. He manages a 20 plus member techno-commercial team comprising of architects, engineers, MBAs, and chartered accountants. Abhijatya has worked with clients such as real estate, infrastructure developers, financial institutions, owners and occupiers across different geographies, including the Middle East, Southeast Asia, and North America. Abhijatya specializes in providing value-added services in areas such as project management, development advisory, review and design of standard operating processes, cost management reviews, risk and compliance management improvement programs, land acquisition reviews, and internal audits. His work experience focuses on aspects such as performance improvement, project and program risk management, enhanced project and cost management, among other areas. Abhijatya serves as an SME for the corporate real estate sector related services for Deloitte. He has worked with several large occupiers, several which include Indian and multinational companies, on expanding and rationalizing their real estate footprint. He has also assisted on several bespoke assignments, including cost reduction exercises and investigations, amongst other consulting assignments across clients. Abhijatya is an avid reader and a travel buff. He is also an amateur golfer with a handicap of 12 and is an overall sports enthusiast. Let me begin now, gentlemen, with my first question to both of you. The first question is, could you describe a key learning from your childhood school days that has stayed with you? And a little explanation to that question is that it could be any kind of learning. It could be in an informal situation which involved elders, teachers, or relatives. And something that has remained with you because it was instilled in you as something very unique.
So to begin with, I would say that behavior is one thing which I have gained from my school days, childhood days. Seriousness is something towards my work. And yes, organizing skills, that has also come to me from my school days. And that is something, because as far as one incident, if you want to me to just say that, behavior is something which I will have to keep in front of my clients and the arbitrators and during arbitration. So that is something which has always stayed with me so far. So that is something from the schooling, I would say.
Right. Yes, Abhijatya?
That's a very interesting question. I think one of the, I was privileged to go to one of the best schools in the city of Calcutta. And, I believe it's one of the best schools. I wouldn't, really count for it. But the fact of the matter remains that we were brought up not just, sound academically, but also on an overall front. We were, there was a very strong sense of sportsmanship that was instilled within us, which meant that we would, in our spare time, ensure that we played all kinds of sports at all kinds of levels. And that included, unique sports like rugby, we used to row, and so on and so forth. And, there was a sense of competitiveness that was also instilled amongst all of us as, students of that era, if I may say so. But what was unique about this entire exercise was not just the fact that, there was a physical, exercise which was put up for it, but the fact of the matter remained that we were also taught to be good sportsmen, and we were also taught to lose graciously. One of the most important aspects that I believe in the professional world is to be able to lose graciously, is to be able to stand up and say that, hey, look, sorry, I made a mistake, and I'm going to walk away from it as graciously as I can. And the other part of it was, to make sure that we never gave up. There were very, very difficult situations. We used to play rugby against the best teams. We used to row. And, all of us were extremely competitive, and rowing meant there were injuries. Rugby meant there were broken bones. But one thing was very sure. If you started it, you would finish it, no matter what, no matter how, no matter when. So that was, I think, something that's driven me as an individual. It's gotten into my subconscious mind as a child. And that's helped me immensely across my career.
Wow. That's something very interesting. That's in fact how important sports is to in making a person, or any other kind of activity other than simply learning. I come to my next question, which is actually, Mayank, you have done your engineering, and Abhijatya, you have done your architecture. So obviously there is always a prescribed curriculum at graduation and also post-graduation. Can you say that you have been able to correlate most of what you learned with what you have now been doing in your professional life? What you studied in the curriculum then and what you are actually over the years been doing in your profession?
I would say whatever I have studied in engineering and in my post-graduation, something or other, one way or the other, I can correlate everything to whatever I do today. I'm from an engineering background. I was into various construction companies before becoming a consultant. And I'm still related to construction. I'm doing delay analysis and cost analysis for various construction projects. So whatever I learned in engineering, whether it was part of curriculum or whether it was an extracurriculum curricular activities in my engineering, I could relate everything, some in small portions, some in larger portions. But yes, everything I can correlate right now. Yeah, during school days, we study everything. So few things would have been dropped. But still, since I'm a reader and I read a lot, that I always recall all those things, whatever I have studied in the school when I read on various subjects. So I would say, of course, I can correlate to everything, whatever I have studied in curriculum or my extracurricular activities.
Okay, thank you. Yes, Abhijatya?
I'm from an architecture background. So, architecture is much about design, less about consulting, as you can imagine. But the fact of the matter remains that, a lot of work that I do today does involve looking at buildings, looking at designs, looking at optimization opportunities, which I probably wouldn't have been able to do if I did not have the background that I do. That being that, probably there is no direct correlation that, you know, practically takes up what I've done in my undergraduate or postgraduate courses for that matter. But fact of the matter remains that in bits and pieces, just the way Mayank suggested, that some in small portions, some in large portions do come in handy on a daily basis. What is also important is that, you know, in especially in the NICMAR Advanced Construction Management Program that I was a part of many, many years ago, we were taught many diverse subjects and, you know, especially things like accounting, business finance, which were absolutely, absolutely unique and new for individuals such as me, which have come in handy because when I walked into the consulting world, I at least knew what was a debit and what was a credit, let alone, you know, not being able to understand how to read a book of accounts or look at a balance sheet that probably developed in due course. But the fact of the matter is that, you know, I did have a stepping stone where I could pick up some of that and take it forward. So, yes, I would say, you know, a lot of this has metamorphosed, much like the imaginal bit that you said, that, you know, the caterpillar becoming the butterfly. Much of it does metamorphose in everyday life for me.
Wonderful. But, you know, I'm not going to leave you so easily. I'm the one who likes to get in to actually go into the depth of it. So my next question is, while Mayank says that most of what he has read, he has been able to use, I would like you to, Abhijatya, you also, to really recall if there are any specific instances where you found that there was a complete mismatch with what you learned or a complete, say, irrelevance of the curriculum and the actual work that you were engaged in.
That's an interesting and a difficult question. But I would say that it is really difficult to say that anything is total mismatch. There are so many things which I found not very interesting when they were in curriculum, which are now very useful, and I have somehow developed interest. And there were some things which I found very interesting. For instance, for an example, I would say I loved a subject I had in fifth semester engineering, if I'm not wrong, called internal combustion engines. I love to drive cars and I love that subject. Somehow I don't do much with it, except for few thermodynamics, which are used in various power projects and other projects which I am associated with these days. But yes, that was an interesting subject which I don't use much. Yeah, there were so many boring subjects. I don't want to name them now because I use them a lot. But yes, now, so it that has happened. I wouldn't say I've dropped something entirely, at least for the post-school education.
That's interesting. You, Abhijatya?
Similar thoughts to what Mayank just suggested. I think, you know, if nothing else, what we've learned works as good conversations. The fact of the matter remains that nothing that you ever read or learn is irrelevant. A very late realization in my life. I wish I had studied more. And I've always kept saying that to you, ma'am, that, you know, maybe if I had probably paid a little more attention to my academics, I would have, you know, probably fared better in life. But unfortunately, you know, no point in crying over spilt milk. But the fact of the matter remains that, you know, even, let's say, for example, something like history of architecture, which was a part of my curriculum when I actually started my architecture degree, I found it extremely dull because, you know, one couldn't, for the love of God, understand why I needed to study that subject. It never really came in business use, if I may say so. I mean, you know, nobody really asked me how many types of churches there are in India, what is Indo-Sassanic architecture for that matter. But it was interesting because, you know, when you do speak to people and people coming in from very myriad, I would say geographies and people who come from various different backgrounds, sometimes these unique aspects, these tidbits actually spicen up conversations which get you closer to them. So the typical elevator pitch that we keep talking about is not always about business. It's about, you know, getting a hook onto the next individual, trying to figure out what that person is interested in and trying to build that connection. So everything I've learned in whatever form and shape has always helped me build that connection. Just to give you a typical example, I spent some time with a client from the Far East, and we did get talking about some stuff, and it was a very dull and boring meeting. We were meeting face to face. I was in his office, but when he heard that I really had a great time in Turkey, and I visited all the mosques, and I could start describing what an onion dome was, he warmed up to me. So maybe not directly in terms of business, but of course that came handy in a conversation. So I really don't think that I've lost anything. I don't think anything is irrelevant. I think nuclear science to microbiology, everything is relevant to every individual who's listening to this, or has anything to do with anything.
But then again, Mayank, your ICEs might just be some history books soon, with the electric cars and the solar vehicles and all, coming.
I think good things don't turn into history.
good. So I'll go to the next question. This is regarding your professional journey. As the span of management or the job role changed, I want to know whether you actually dropped some competencies, and if yes, which were those? And a corollary to that, did you add any specific skills, and did you acquire them organically, or you acquired them through, say, new skill development, like through training or taking a course or something like that? So.
Okay, I was a maintenance engineer prior to my post-graduation, after my graduation. So that is something, I was a good maintenance engineer, but somehow that's completely dropped. After NICMAR and other postgraduate courses, I ended up into construction and then a consultant. So basically that is dropped, but yes, I acquired a lot of competencies through training. Yes, through various trainings which I achieved in my previous organizations and in my through my curriculum, and they are like operations into operations and business management and marketing, human resource management, these through various trainings. But organically, I learned so many things about the pipeline industry. I was into pipeline laying for a very long time, and delay analysis, which is my bread and butter these days. So delay analysis is something I acquired organically, and then the cost associated to prolongation delays in prolongations and construction projects. These are the things I have acquired, and then few formal trainings also happen, and now I'm a known trainer in the industry for all these things. So I have not just acquired, and by God's grace, I think so I've excelled in some of them. So yeah,
that's good. Yeah, that's so important, because when you do a delay analysis, that's important, because every project of the magnitude that you are analyzing, like we are talking about an infrastructure project, runs into so many millions, and mostly with public money. So delays and all are extremely important and have to be studied more acutely, I guess, than they were before. Yes, Abhijatya?
So, ma'am, I don't think I've dropped anything. Consulting has been very kind to me. It's given me a lot of opportunity to do very different and very, khichdi, if I may use the word, of the type of work that I do. So at any given point in time, I have been pulled in many directions, sometimes as a project manager, sometimes as a compliance expert, sometimes as part of an internal audit team, sometimes leading an internal audit team. And that's kind of resulted in the fact that I don't think I've ever dropped anything. I strongly believe that there is a case for good training and professional education, continual professional education. That's because probably I've had none. I've really not gone through any training or anything over the course of my career. Whatever I've learned is extremely organic. I can, probably talk a lot about finance and accounting today, which is, something that I could not have imagined at a point in time. It's like, chalk and cheese, really, what I actually, you know, started doing in life and where I have reached today and what I'm doing today. And I enjoy that. I think the thrill is in the fact that you continue to do different things, different days of the week, and probably the same day. I mean, you know, you wear a hat in the morning and, you know, you're a clown in the evening. So that's the thrill of consulting. It can be tiring, but the fact of the matter is that you learn continuously. You learn organically. I wish I had spent some time acquiring some skills and, you know, getting some formal trainings in the due course of things. But I don't regret the fact that a lot of what I've learned is organic in nature. So that's been my journey, to be really honest. I have some colleagues who have taken a good professional certifications, and I envy them for it. Maybe I'm just too lazy. And like I said, you know, I wish I'd studied harder. And I wish I continued to study harder, something that I've not been doing very well. But they're doing very well for themselves with their professional certifications. They've gotten career advancements. They've been able to tap into more opportunities as experts. And, you know, I believe there's a very, very strong case for continual education.
Okay. Thank you. That was very, very interesting. And thank you for being honest, because that's so important. Abhijatya, you, I think when I read your CV, you said you read a lot. So I guess this organically comes out of all that reading that you do, and you've not really gone for a formal certification, but you keep yourself abreast with what's happening. So my next question, of course, is I've seen, Mayank, that you belong to the technical project consulting domain. So a lot of technical stuff has to be, I mean, you have to have mastery over it, even to be an be invited as an arbitration expert, or even do a delay analysis, or any of those, the contract document that you look after. It's obviously your technicals have to be almost near perfect. While Abhijatya, you, I guess, could be slotted as a projects and a management domain consulting specialist, being in Deloitte. So this is to both of you. I mean, Mayank, which particular technical and non-technical skills are needed for consulting professionals in the built environment? So, and after that, Abhijatya, you could take the question, please.
Yes. So the, as far as technical is concerned, the entire technical know-how that I have learned in my engineering, as I said in one of your previous questions, it's something or other which I learned in my curriculum and throughout my career comes back to me somehow, because I cater to various pillars of the construction. I'm into oil and gas, I'm into power, I'm into infrastructure. So it doesn't matter, I'm a mechanical engineer by graduation. I take care of civil, I take care of electrical. So that technical know-how is with me, and I'm able to use it in the technical analysis and the delay analysis and the quantum analysis as and when required. The other thing is the detailed knowledge of project management. I started as a planner after NICMAR. So I was a planner, then a senior planner, then a project manager before becoming a consultant. So everything, again, all the technicalities of all those projects and the remembrances of all those projects remain with me. So these are the technical competencies or technical things which I have and which I use so much in delay, quantum, and technical analysis. The non-technical are the most important is the communication skills. When I'm sitting in a witness box and cross-examined by the biggest lawyers in the countries, I have to give an answer which cannot be interpreted in the way which I don't want to be.
Absolutely.
So that is something where communications, and I should thank you a lot for that, ma'am. Second thing, because yes, interpretation becomes important. Second is the report writing skills. One should understand what is a formal English, what is informal English. So what kind of language is to be used? Again, it should be the interpreted. It should be interpreted in the way I want them to be interpreted. There should not be a second interpretation to it. And definitely all those business development and business management skills, and some contractual and legal knowledge, which comes from it. So these are the non-technical skills which are actually required for us.
So ma'am, as far as I'm concerned, I think any technical knowledge is welcome into consulting. When I mean any technical knowledge, this is the day of super specialization. Every individual who comes into consulting has to find a path for him or herself. And, knowing something in depth and knowing, I would say, a couple of subjects in depth is a very, very important trait that is being sought by multiple clients across the globe. It's almost like medicine, where I would say there was an ENT, there was a era where we would look at ENTs. Now we have folks who probably focus on 6 square centimeters of the body, and they specialize in that very, very well, right? So that's the kind of thing that's been looked at, because everybody wants a person who's an expert in whatever their problem is. So when I started my career, I used to do fit outs. I was a contractor. I was on site. I was doing fit outs. And, in the early days, nobody would actually consider that as an experience. They'd just look at me and say that, these are 6-7 month projects. What are you talking about, man? I mean, they don't hold any relevance. We're looking at consulting for multi-billion dollar projects and multi-million dollar projects. But in time, I built a niche. I looked around and I found that there was a gap, that people did not trust their contractors, people were getting fleeced. And that turned out to be an extremely remunerative way to build a business. And honestly speaking, I'm still building it, but it's what I believe immensely, that if you become a jack of all trades and you try and do many things at the same time, you do tend to lose out on some aspects. But it's very important to know everything, in the sense to be able to at least stand up in a conversation, say that, I've done this and I've done this as well. And I bring in experiences. So, at a junior level, I'm guessing, and then you start off in your consulting life, doing many, many things is a very, very important aspect, but you really need to find your niche in due course. And that will come in from the one thing that is probably inorganically or organically built into your career, the first job that you found, the first skill set that you found. So that kind of develops from there. On the if I look back at the non-technical skills, I think the one skill that you need to have is to be able to hustle. I'm sorry, I'm using the word, but the fact of the matter is that consulting is entrepreneurship. You are an entrepreneur. You follow a certain set of guidelines. You sell, you hire people, you execute, you deliver, you bill, you collect, you are HR, you are finance, you are everything that is in the system, right? So you need to be able to hustle. You need to be able to move from one conversation, which could be about hiring, to one conversation about firing, the next conversation about finance, about billing, about gross margins. So if your mind is not flexible enough to probably capture these aspects, you're not built for it. I'm not saying that everybody is. If I were probably put into a planning role, I would probably fail miserably, because I can't look at a 6,000 line item MSP file and do a great job at it. That's not me. But the hustling and the fact of the matter remains that the ability to don various hats at the same time is something that you need to ingrain in yourself, if this is something that you want to do. And one aspect which I think Mayank would concur with me on is the ability to handle pressure. You will be put in situations which are not the most conducive. You will have hard disks crashing when you're about to give a presentation. You will have Zoom calls switching off with internet connections not working. You will have flat tires when you're going for a meeting and you're wearing a suit. You will have difficult stakeholders to answer questions to. CFOs will change, CEOs will change, board members will change, questions will change. But the ability to handle it, the ability to read the environment and to continue is an extremely important aspect. You lose hair. Mayank and me are typical examples. We are almost bald. I won't say much about Mayank, but at least I am. So the fact of the matter is
that even I am.
So the idea is that it's just that how happy are you about losing that hair? How are you able to handle your personal life and be able to create that that beautiful symphony where you enjoy this pressure? Because if you cannot take this pressure, you feel that you're not built for this pressure, then consulting is not for you. And there's nothing wrong in not being for you. I mean, this skill is not, it's not a skill. It's just probably majburi, if I may say so. But that fact remains that you need to make sure that you have it.
Yes. Now, that's so candid and so true. I'm really liking this. And, because you spoke, even if we exceed this 1 hour today, I'm happy because you all are bringing so much to this conversation. Now, because you all spoke about this, and this is exactly what I have been thinking, because when I look at a cohort of students, I see that their nature, their basic nature and their inclination is different. And therefore, to get a good start, they should actually go where they are easy. For instance, Abhijyoti, you said that you were not the planning kind and you were not the one to look at spreadsheets on and on. So, as teachers, we could sense that and we would do this kind of little bit of counseling and say that perhaps, because everybody wants consultancies at the placement. It's crazy how students just want to be in a consultant's role, and it takes a lot. And then there is that it doesn't work out. And like you saw, Abhijyoti and Mayank, you all have actually come into consulting sometime later. Perhaps that was also good for you because you all are actually now much better off in terms of understanding the grueling routines and the kind of macro, interests that you have. As you said, on the one hand, you're looking at a billing, problem. On another, you're talking to a board member. On another, you're with a CFO. It's like, you're wearing different hats at the same time. So that kind of maturity comes only after a period of time. And that's why what you're saying actually has a big bearing on those who will listen to this or catch this on YouTube even later, and not to actually be hasty about getting into consultancies soon after their placements or whatever. So that's something important. And actually, this question comes up with and is related to another question, which I was going to ask you. What are those important personality attributes that are desirable in aspirants in the consulting profession? And could you enumerate the key professional skills to be acquired if they are not there? As I said, not all of us are equipped with all the skills that are ideal for a consulting profession. So what can those be? So quickly, if both of you can tell us some key attributes of the personality that are essential to actually aspire for this profession, and two, if they are not there, then how can you build on that? So
first of all, yes, I would agree here that one should acquire some skill at a very good level before entering into the consultancy, because when you are in consultancy, you are advising somebody how he should spend his money. So you should be good at it. So first of all, I feel for being a consultant, you should have a problem-solving ability. Now, to attain that problem-solving ability, you should have an ability to understand the problem first. You should clearly understand the problem first, then comes the problem-solving ability. Now, to understand the problem, you should be a diligent person, and one should be having a habit of detailing into the things. You can't look at things superficially when you are in consulting. You have to get into right to the root cause of every problem. So detailing becomes very important. So these are the personality skills which one should try to have or one should have. Now, other than this, what can come from the education is the whatever you have seen, whatever problem you have seen, how better you are communicating to your clients or other parties, which I said communication skills become important. And the command over the language, because again, you should not be misinterpreted, as I have already said. And definitely, when you are working for somebody like Mason or FTI or PwC, then definitely you should have that techno-legal skill within you or techno-commercial skill within you, where you can actually get the right interpretation of legal clauses and give a correct commercial figure to the claims and all those things.
Right. So true. So true. Yes. Yes, Abhijyoti.
So I completely agree with what Mayank has said. I think what he said is absolutely spot on. The only thing that I would like to add on is that I believe there's only one way to attain what Mayank has alluded as certain skill sets that you need to have, and that is to read. The fact of the matter remains that we as a country are not we are not very, words for it, but we don't like to read. We believe that reading is part of our curriculum, and we read certain textbooks which were provided to us, and that's about it. After that, it's television, and in today's world, phones and iPads and, you know, YouTube and Instagrams and Facebooks of the world take up so much of our time. To anybody who's listening to this, if you want to get to a consulting career and you believe you're made for it, the fact of the matter is that what Mayank has suggested is absolutely spot on. Communication, clarity of thought, poise, command over the English language, confidence in yourself, and all of this stems from reading. Please read. Please, you know, I would say start off by reading every single word of the Economic Times every single day of your life for at least a year. Read the Business Standard. Read any paper which is not white. Read the white paper as well. Read books. Read random books. Go to the airport when you're traveling. Pick up a book. Read it through and through. Force yourself to read. If you read, you will have a, you know, a view which is you know, which is not narrow, to say the least. You understand the world a lot better. You understand subjects which are not which are not probably things that you've been taught, and that's the only way to attain what Mayank is suggesting. So do that and you are there. Read every day of your life. Read till the last day of your life if you want to get it.
Wonderful. In fact, I must tell you that the audience is responding very well. We have Nishant Sethi who's saying, great to know how the scenes behind consultant leaders look like, which otherwise are hard to crack through their usual professional conversations. And we have a lot of audience participations. Vinod Dublekar has said, how to lose is a good skill to learn and have. It's important for managing disappointments and stress. And I think, Abhijatya, you were talking about that in the beginning of the session. Mayank, do you recall I had given you all a task of reading a book in one of my such a pain. I still remember that people were struggling and, you know, everybody had to read one book in that trimester, and then I was giving them marks, you know. It was an assignment, so to say. So, yes. We can never we can never underscore enough the importance of reading when it comes to consulting careers. So my usual line for all of you all used to be read and read some more, you know. So how true. Nice to hear that coming back. So my next question, we are 47 minutes into this and we still have some time. So we are doing pretty good time. My next question is to both of you. In your opinion, how important is competency-based education to develop the human resource? You all know that India has been known to give a lot of, generic kind of education. And compared to other societies, we have less of competency-based education. So, and also, along with that, I would like to know, how important is training in ethics and conduct, transparency in dealing, important for consultants?
So the first part, competency-based education, I feel as a consultant, as a partner in Mason Projects Private Limited, is very, very important. Because when I go out for conducting campus interviews in institutes like NICMAR and other such institutes, my problem is what we do sometimes sounds like Hebrew to the students. and we have to develop them from scratch. But somehow, in all those years of my career, I have been doing good in developing trainees rather than taking experienced people and developing them into consultants. So definitely, if some of these such trainings, I have been advising to Ahmed, when you were with MRICS, I had some piece of advice to MRICS as well, why don't you introduce such courses? And I've been advising to NICMAR and Symbiosis type of institutes to introduce certain courses, which actually will give competency-based education. So yes, it is important. We have to be more niche. I mean, every consultant is working in a niche area. I mean, he's excellent in his part of work and part of world. So if you get something ready-made from the education society or institutions, that's helpful and good for this society and education and the students as well. As far as training in ethics, it is very important because we consultants I'm a dispute management consultant. Whenever there is a dispute between two parties, I am one of the parties appoint me to be his dispute resolution partner. Right. Now, if I have been somewhere associated to the other party somehow, it is my duty to disclose it to my new client that, okay, if you find it a conflict of interest, I can move out. So as a consultant, right. I mean, big fours like, I mean, definitely Abhijat would agree, big fours have a system of finding that. And they have a very ethical, which we Indian companies are starting to develop now, and we have done it good. And, but that, definitely that ethical training is required at the ground level, at the educational level, which then takes forward into the organization.
That's very good. That's very good. Abhijat?
Ma'am, I think competency-based training is very, very important. I think, I mean, there is the one thing that is lacking in our education system today is competency-based training. While I also think that even our current education system is doing very well in producing good talent. When I mean this, what I mean by this is the fact that, the students that actually come out of the system today are far more exposed and, probably aware than what I was, at least when I was graduating. And that's a very good thing. I think the world has evolved in many ways, which makes individuals automatically aware of things which, probably I had no clue about. Like the internet in my days was a privilege. Now it is a necessity, right? So people have access to the internet. People do Google stuff. People read, people find news articles, and they are very well informed. I find a lot of students, when I go out and speak to them, seem to have a good knowledge about a various number of things which I had never even heard of in my life in college, right? So I am very impressed by how the world is evolving in terms of providing information to students. But yes, we must understand that academics is not the end of the world. We must understand the fact that, not everyone is built for academics. If you actually are able to find what is interesting to an individual, you will probably be able to feed them that kind of stuff, that kind of information, which would actually make them grow. We tend to measure the fish and the monkey with the same yardstick, that is probably climbing the tree. The monkey does it very easily and the fish struggles. So it's just that I think it's very, very important for us to be able to guide our students and do so in a manner which is not derogatory in nature. We had, I won't name people, but people would actually walk up in my college days and tell me that you're horrible at drawing. You'll never make an architect. And I said, yes, I'm terrible at it. I mean, I accept it. I mean, but, I wish somebody would have just walked up to me and told me that, why don't you look at civil engineering for that matter, or look at something as myriad as, probably English literature. I would have done very well, I believe. But I didn't have that backup to, actually go back home and look at my parents in the face and say that, sorry, I can't do this architecture course and I can't really take this forward. We all come from middle-class families. The middle-class values that we have sometimes don't permit us to do these things. But if there was a culture in this country which helped me identify opportunities of interest and take that forward as good professional opportunities, maybe I would have been a very different person today, right? So I think that that's a very, very important aspect. The second part of it, ethics. See, we are professionals, man. We are entrepreneurs. We are individuals who advise people who many a time come across extremely sensitive information and, which could damage organizations, which could damage, individual careers, which could do a lot of harm if, probably not handled with kid gloves. Right. So information security has become of paramount importance. And similarly, ethics, when I look at ethics, ethics is a very, very broad term. It involves everything from the amount of time you actually spend on your computer, the hours that you log into your timesheet to say how many hours you work for a certain client, because you bill them accordingly. And onwards to your financial transactions, like in the Big Four, where I stand today, I can't trade in securities which are which are restricted, where we are audit, where we have audit relationships. It's very, very important that ethics is first of all, there's no violation, but even then, you know, probably the optics of a violation also don't exist. And nobody can ever say that if I own 50 shares of an audit company that, you know, I knew something about it. I mean, that's a bizarre argument.
Right.
But the optics of ethics is also very important beyond the ethics. So you can imagine how important it is. Our bank accounts are monitored by the firm. Our securities are monitored by the firm. We have actually had to give up passwords and people see how much money we make. But that's all a part of, you know, absolute levels of transparency that we offer to our clients and, you know, probably to ourselves, because our credibility in the market is all about ethics. If you are unethical, the news will spread. People will know. Once people know, they will never come back to you. We are not politicians. We are not people who can, you know, backtrack on things that we've done in the past. So it's very, very important to stay grounded. You know, money comes, money goes, information comes, information goes. But what you need to do is a long-term vision. So I think ethics training is very, very important from that perspective.
So true. In fact, if you see, there are few professions in this world which need more than normal degrees and levels of ethics. Like, I think education is one of those. So yes. Unless and until we hold ourselves to extremely high standards, we can't expect our the ones whom we train to actually even take a little bit out of that. So you'll see that only those institutions that hold themselves to extremely high standards generally do well. And consultancies and banking and also government, of course, the bureaucracy are those professions where I feel there's a lot that needs to be done. And we don't have to go too far. And we've seen what happened in 2008. It was Lehman Brothers and it was all these that brought so much grief to the whole world. So how true what you say, Abhijatya and Mank. And that's why that's one quotient that needs to develop separately and deliberately, so to say. I think that's what's coming out from your response. So I'm now moving towards the end of the session, and I have a couple of questions in that. I would like to focus your attention on the larger problems that surround us, such as natural environmental risks or youth skill development, digitalization, fair access to development, or the role of stakeholders. Now, you have covered a lot of this, but if you can just quickly in one sentence say, how can entrepreneurship be a preferred way in the alleviation of these global problems? And in which areas and in which manner? Because see, consultants, as you say, they are entrepreneurs. You actually grow yourself into partnership at the highest level in the company. So how can this kind of entrepreneurship as an attitude, entrepreneurship as a career, how can that help to solve these very tough and very myriad and very large scale problems that we are now facing? So a quick word on that from both of you.
Yeah, I mean, definitely entrepreneurship is an answer to all the problems which we have just listed out. But again, so many things become debatable when you are an entrepreneur, especially in the world of consulting. So all debatable things need to be taken care of, answered properly. One should have an accountability of what work he or she has been doing. Okay, this is what I have done. If there are mistakes, if something has gone wrong, I am the one who is responsible. And if everything has fantastic, I am the one who did it. So the kind of, again, the moral code of conduct is the second thing, which is very important in an entrepreneurship, because that is where we were talking about ethics. We were talking about so many things. Moral code of conduct leads you into such ethical environment. Again, seriousness towards work, and definitely work on organizational culture. That is something is more important when you are working on these things. I mean, on all those problems which we talked about, I see youth skill development is something which is more area of concern right now. We being so populated country, some or the other skills should be acquired at some stage. And the next part is the digitalization. I mean, okay, I grew up in a very small town and I grew up in early 90s and late 80s. So when I was doing a research, I used to visit a library to find a book. Now, when I'm searching for one book, I come across 10 other books. And then I note them in mind. Okay, this is the book I want to read when I come back next. Digitalization, you Google everything, you lose those 10 books. So that is a bigger threat I see. And again, reading is something which Abhijit has been advocating since the start of the session. So I'm totally with him on that. And so entrepreneurship requires all these things, and you become automatically accountable for your job, whatever work you do. Yeah. So that's how I look at it. Yeah.
So ma'am, I think, resonating from what ma'am just said, entrepreneurship in itself is not the answer, is what I believe. What is very important that should come with entrepreneurship is sense of regulation. In this country, to be an entrepreneur, you need no qualification, right? So you can just stand up tomorrow and become a builder, you can become a contractor, you can become an electrician, you can open a shop, and you can just get on with life. Look at the developed world. How does the developed world look at entrepreneurs? They are respected people, people who are, very good at what they do. They're not just, they're not just folks who open up random stores and shops and, becoming contractors tomorrow. There is a process to become a builder or a contractor. There are licenses to be had. There are registrations to be made. How is that important? That's very important, because that's where you ensure the quality of service. Entrepreneurship is very, very important. Like I said, Mayank and to some extent me, I'm not a partner yet in my firm, but we are entrepreneurs in our own right, right? But we are regulated by a certain set of code, a certain set of regulations that the firms impose upon us, which could vary as much as what we wear to how we behave, to what we do with respect to our contracts, how do we engage with our clients, and how do we actually deliver. And that is why these firms have reached where they have. Now, if it was just a mom and pop shop, which did not really need any form of, formal accreditation, I could have very well been, having a colleague who's wearing a t-shirt and shorts and going to a client, and I could be wearing a suit, and that would have been just our own individual perspectives, right? So the quality of entrepreneurship needs to improve. The world needs to look at least our country needs to look at individuals who are skilled. That's where the competency-based skills come in, where people are trained, where it's not looked at as something which is, which is not good. Like people say, "Tu bada hoke kya banega? Electrician banega? Ya plumber banega?" I mean, what's wrong? I mean, there's nothing wrong in being an electrician or a plumber, right? But if I'm a great plumber, then I could make a truckload of money, much more than what I could have been making at any point in time, and I could be absolutely fantastic. I could become a great PHE contractor and take the world for it. Fact of the matter again. Let's look at regulating entrepreneurship, providing that competency-based training to individuals who have interests in certain areas, and also weeding out people who are not offering that level of service. It's right. Very, very important, because otherwise entrepreneurship is like, you could become an entrepreneur tomorrow morning and you could do something which doesn't have any control over the quality of service. Oh. People are unhappy. That doesn't work.
Yeah. So it's like moss. It can grow anywhere, right. So standards are important. I agree. Even these entrepreneurs have to actually work against a certain professional standard. Good. That's a very good point. Really fantastic. Now, I'm not going to take too much time. This Mayank and Abhijata, last question from me. And there are many questions that the audience is asking, and I think time should be kept for that. Just a quick one on your message. I have written a book on for millennials, and so obviously I cannot end any session of mine without covering, and you all are millennials too. So my question is, which key attitudes and skills would millennials and Generation Z need going forward, and why? So quickly, before the audience questions are taken.
Well,
on this.
Yeah, millennials and Generation Z basically are not millennials exactly, but yes, Generation Z, or the people who are still young. I am young, but younger than me. So still young, they are born with internet. Now, internet,
Mayank, I'm younger than you too, huh?
By the way. I take that, ma'am. I take that. I always take that. So basically, they are born with internet, and for them, for answer to every question becomes internet. Somehow, what Abhijati was saying, read the papers that come in all colors, white or not white. Go to the library, search for the books. Definitely, you will see so many things which you don't want at that point of time, but definitely you will remember, okay, it was there, so I can get back to it anytime, which I don't know, somehow doesn't happen with internet. Definitely with digitalization and evolvement of internet, for we consultants have an easier life now. I'm a delay analyst. I everything I take to the delay. So if I don't have Primavera or Microsoft projects, I will be hitting my head badly with concurrent delays. Now these two softwares take care of it. I don't have to look towards them.
Correct.
So that is good. That is good. But I wouldn't have learned delay analysis because it came to me organically, and I wouldn't have learned it if I wouldn't have gone to libraries for reading material. So reading is a habit, reading is an attitude, and definitely detailing. One more thing I want to say with this Generation Z, I'm seeing a casual attitude right now. Very casual attitude, not exactly with entire generation, but with a lot of people in it. Which they are so casual about everything, including work. Abhijati was saying, somebody walking in for a client meeting in a jeans and t-shirt, that's not acceptable. It really sometimes becomes hard to tell people, okay, this is not acceptable. So casual approach is something which needs to be, office time is office time. I mean, work time is work time. So definitely. So that's the two things, my piece of advice, that's personal thoughts.
Thank you.
I think I have just one specific piece of advice for all millennials, whether they're listening to this or not. And fact of the matter remains that I think they're far smarter than I am. I am an old millennial. I'm not a young millennial. I have enough grays in my head and in my beard, which remind me every day that I'm not as young as I used to be. But the only one quality, one trait that I wish that could develop is patience. That's all I ask of them. I think they're very smart bunch of people coming out, hyper-connected, hyper-achievers, individuals with, with potentials which are unbelievable. They, contrary to what Mayank has said, I have seen some millennials perform exceedingly well when they, actually put their mind to it. They sit across the table. Some of them dress better than I do, and some of them have better poise than I do. And like I said, I really look up to some of my junior colleagues because they are able to do things which probably I can't and never will be able to. But the only thing that I request of them is to be patient. See, the fact of the matter remains, and I keep saying the fact of the matter, these are things which come to us from experience, and which is why I'm trying to probably press on this. There will be only one Steve Jobs, there will be only one Bill Gates. These people are done and dusted with whatever they're doing. You are you. You have your own destiny to make. You have your own career to make. You have your own life to make. You have your own family to grow. You have phenomenal potential in whatever you do. Please don't think that if you've not conquered the world in 2 years, that you're a failure. And then try and look for a different profession or a different job or something else. Sometimes it just takes that much time to settle in, to dig in, to say that, it's like, batting in a test match, right? Life is not a 20-20 match. It actually goes on for 5 full days. It's a game of golf. There are 18 holes to play. If you lose, if you fare badly on one, doesn't mean that the next one is going to be great. And vice versa, right? You could birdie one and, you're all over in the next. So please dig in. Please relax. Please give yourself defined goals over years and say that, I'm going to give my profession, my organization some time. And I'm sure you'll do fantastically.
That's It's really been, there are so many comments pouring in, so many suggestions that have been asked of you. And I'm winding up here now. So thank you, Mayank and Abhijatya, for your candid responses. From this talk, I can summarize that few of the skills that have enabled your personal and professional growth have been that you learn to be sincere and learn to be a sport when in your childhood. You all treated nothing as irrelevant and, you know, thought that whatever you have learned has come or stood you in good stead sometime later. You were both very open to new learning. Your technical know-how in engineering and technology is essential, is how Mayank, you said, you know, that. And of course, your detailed knowledge as a project management person, that is also very important. You also said that, both of you said that communication skills, business development, business management, contractual knowledge, domain knowledge, and also knowing things that are outside of your domain. As Abhijatya, you gave the example of an onion dome that actually helped to thaw the kind of meeting that you were having with a Gulf executive. So in something like domain knowledge is, in depth is essential. That's something you don't want anybody to compromise on in for consulting careers. And in personality, you say that being an entrepreneur is important. So you need to be a pretty entrepreneurial, and you have to have an ability to handle pressure and stress. And Mayank, you say that as advisors, we need to have a problem-solving ability. That's so important. And we have to have an eye for detail. That is what Abhijatya also says. And the ability to move from different problems in one single day and still not get and still do justice to each one of them. So reading is something that both of you think is absolutely essential. And of course, poise and command on language is also what you have advised. So now, Nidhi, over to you. And could you help, please? Thank you, Mayank and Abhijatya, from my side.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am. Pleasure being here.
It was indeed a very interesting and wonderful session. Yes, we have received a lot of questions, and I would pick a few considering the time that we have in hand right now. I would also like to thank the audience for their very motivating compliments, the questions, and the way they engaged with us this time. It was really encouraging, and this certainly pushes us to keep it going. I'll just move to the first question now. So the first question is from Mr. Joy Bohmik. He's asking, how much betterment can data analytics or machine learning can contribute in the field of business consultation, and how much of them are being used in India? Anybody of you can take
this. Yeah, any knowledge, any skill is very contributory. Data analytics is something which all we consultants do. As far as machine learning is concerned, I'm not the person who can comment much upon it. But yes, these fields are being looked very high, also in the consulting world and in the total business world. How much of them being used in India? I don't know. I mean, I'm not the right person to comment on it. But yes, this is something which is talked about a lot. I can say that.
I think this is, I see a lot of data analytics and machine learning and artificial intelligence being used in businesses today in all forms and shapes. Like my fellow colleague said, I'm not an expert in any of these areas. I probably work with people who work in these areas, but I can only tell you that the sky is the limit as far as each of these aspects is concerned. I have seen some fantastic outputs coming in from ML and AI in the real estate sector. Stuff that was probably sci-fi 5 years ago. You know, we were looking at stuff which is looking at data, giving answers to certain problems which were unsolvable And I've seen my colleagues actually crack them with the help of data. You know, the saying goes within the firm that if you torture data hard enough, it will give you any answer that you feel like. So we've seen this working very, very well. Enjoy. This is something that has a great potential for the future as well.
Thank you, both of you. We'll take up the next question now. Okay, this question is for Abhijatya. Sandeep is asking this question. He is asking, in case of urban development projects, does the PPP model work effectively? In your opinion, do consultants take into account the human-related risks while preparing the feasibilities?
So, Sandeep, to your question, PPP models do work, but the fact of the matter remains that, you know, we don't really leverage them well enough. As a country, we see opportunities where, you know, money can be made much faster than what it should be made, which cause troubles to these models. I have seen multiple cases where, you know, very sustainable business models have been ruined by either inaction from the government or and the wrong intent from the private partner. I think both of those aspects are the ones which ruin it. By itself, the PPP model is fantastic. And on the human aspect, I think ESG and that is environmental social governance, as well as HSC in India, is picking up. We as a firm pay a lot of attention to these aspects now, and we've been doing so for the past 5-7 years. But you know, unfortunately, the penetration of this thought process in our country is very, very low. Probably just because we are so populous, and there's always somebody who's willing to take a shortcut to something to get done. The Western world is far advanced, and you know, I sincerely hope that the you know, the country actually picks up on these items.
Correct. Okay, thank you so much, Abhijatya. Let's go on to the next question. Next question is being asked by Mr. Jignesh. He says, you have worked across geographies with foreign executives, expats. Can you highlight some of the key competencies that are must to have if we want to move up the ladder? I think this question is for both of you.
I have said that during the questions from Madam, I've said that the two major competencies are reading and detailing. These are the two very important competencies, and definitely the communication skills and effectively not getting misinterpreted is something most important I have seen in my profession.
No, I just think that you know, the one thing that is admired in any language, in any geography, by any gender, is the ability to actually to hear and to be able to process what you're hearing and be able to communicate effectively. It's not just, you know, saying what you want to say. It's about hearing what the other person is saying, being able to process it, to be able to throw out something which is absolutely relevant to that person. And to be able to do it while thinking on your feet, sitting across a boardroom, across a Zoom call or whatever else. The only way, fact of the matter is, again, English is not native to us. We've been taught English as a language by our teachers, by our schools. And, you know, our understanding of English is limited to whatever Renan Martins that we've learned. I don't think Renan Martin exists anymore, but it is what's been taught to us. But that's not English. You know, you see the Western world, individuals actually communicate very, very effectively. There is not much faff around what they say. Their communication is to the point and is extremely relevant to whatever conversation is being had. We as Indians tend to talk too much around the bush and not talk about the bush itself, right? So we just look around left, right, and center, and nobody's really talking about the elephant in the room. So learn to talk about the elephant in the room, call it an elephant, say that it's gray, it's got a tail and a trunk. Let's not behave like blind men. That is the only way you're going to be able to communicate with foreign expats. There's no other way to do it.
Thank you so much. And this was really good. This has really done justice to the question asked. We move to the next question now. So this question is from Mr. Chiranjay. He's asking, what advice would millennials give to the older generation to accommodate our generation's way of thinking and working? A very nice question.
I don't know what Chiranjay is trying to say. Is he trying to say that we are old? Or what? Where is this question coming from? I'm not old. I'm far too young.
Yeah,
very young as well. Very, yeah. this is very, 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 very upsetting to say the least. But I'll just say that, that was just, this is just a joke, Chiranjay. But let me just put it like this, that I think the older generation, and I count myself to be in the cusp of the old and the young, somewhere right in the middle. And soon I will be old, but I'm not old yet. I believe that, the younger generation needs more flexibility in everything that they do. The time that they work, the food that they eat, their likes, their dislikes, the way that they operate. I think we should give them that flexibility. And there are great things to be done by giving them that flexibility. If we try and, like I said, measure the fish and the monkey by their ability to climb a tree, and believe that, just because we are baboons who can climb trees very, very well, and everybody should be able to climb a tree, I think we're going to absolutely miss the bus. Good talent will be lost. Good talent will be lost to unhappiness more than, anything else. Millennials are more in touch with their emotions. We need to, ensure that they are, that their emotions are well respected. That's the advice that I would give to anyone.
Yes, in fact, we need to trust the intelligence of younger generations, youngsters who are coming into this. And if they have a sincere approach, we need to understand their thought process. We need to give it a chance. And we definitely need to respect their ideas, because definitely they are more conversant to the younger world right now. I mean, more younger world. I'm still young, as I said. So definitely the thought process has to be respected. And if it is sincere, why not? That should be.
I mean, they're different, right? I mean, I completely say that the millennials are different. I mean, I was walloped in school till, I couldn't sit. None of these guys have been walloped. So, I mean, why believe that they will heed to any form of walloping? So, that's how I would put it. I mean,
And Abhijatya, to just add to that, we were walloped by our parents also, not just in
absolutely,
school, but at home also.
Of course.
Absolutely.
Of
course. So this is what I'm saying, that, that's unheard of today, right? So just look at how, I would say, drivers change. I did a lot of things out of fear. They will never do anything out of fear. I look at some of my junior colleagues. If I yell at them, they will just shut off and go home. So there is nothing to be had by yelling at these people. When I was yelled at, I would piss my pants, man. I'm sorry.
I agree to every word.
My seniors would tell me to stay up at night, not doing anything, staring at a computer screen. I would stay up at night, staring at a computer screen. Today, people will ask me questions. Why should I stay up? Can I not sleep? What is the problem? Fair. There's nothing to be had by, just following the old ways.
Yeah, and if they ask questions, they need to be answered properly. They should not be kept aside. No, you can't ask the question. We were not allowed to ask, but we should allow others to ask the questions.
Absolutely.
Wonderful. This was really wonderful. We'll go to the last question. Another question by Mr. Sandeep for Mayank. According to you, what extent are consultants held responsible in case there are contractual risks that come into play, especially in the case of global contractors employed in an infrastructure project?
See, very good question, actually, Sandeep. Now, let me tell you, as consultants, we come across this situation a lot. We do give all sorts of disclaimers before starting up a report and writing, but yes, we are held responsible when we are on advisory role, when we are advising how to draft a contract, what kind of clauses you should enter into those contracts, and if they go wrong, and if they are open to misinterpretations, definitely our client is not going to leave us. I've seen people being taken to court because of giving wrong advice, which actually, and if we are an expert witness in an arbitration where stakes are high and you are disregarded as a witness because of your lack of diligence or lack of deliverance, definitely your clients don't leave you so easily. And definitely it also affects your career. You don't get, as Abhijit said, if you are not doing proper work, or if, I think he said for ethics, but it also falls true for is true for the hard work and the diligence which you have done into. If you're not going to do it properly, you are not going to get further work. So we are held responsible. We are taken to courts. And fortunately, I have not been taken to court so far, but you don't even know. But yeah, we are held responsible for contractual risks. And that's true. So yeah, we have to be very careful, even after giving all sorts of disclaimers in our reports.
Thank you so much, Mayank. So with this, we have come to an end of this episode. Before we close the session, please click on the link shared in the chat box to enable us to make Imaginal Talk episodes even more relevant to you. All those viewers who would like to have a certificate of attendance may please leave their email addresses in the chat box. For all those who have missed this session today, the talk will be available on VSAR Imaginal Talk Series on Learning and Skill Development YouTube next week. Please like, follow, and subscribe to the Imaginal Talks on YouTube and Imaginal Blogs on YRP Systems website. Thank you so much, viewers, for joining us today and engaging with us through comments and questions. Signing out and looking forward to having you once again in the next episode with yet another distinguished guest. Bye for now and stay with Imaginal. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you all.
Thank you, Mayank. Thanks, Abhijatya. It was fantastic.
Thank you, ma'am and Nidhi.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. It was really lovely.